to do science without having to do all the pain that sometimes involved in working with complicated data sets. So just to kind of give you a brief overview of who I am, I've actually been working on the JMars project for about 6 years now. I'll just jump right into what is JMars. Actually, so a couple years ago at ASU, I actually taught a seminar about JMars, and over a 5-week period, I gave what I considered an introduction to the tool. So I'm trying to give you a 5-minute overview. I'm not going to do a terribly good job, but as was mentioned, there is a longer demonstration available on Wednesday for anybody who wants to come and see a more in-depth presentation, ask questions, and see some live demonstrations of what this tool can do. So basically, JMars is actually an acronym, stands for Java Mission Planning and Analysis for Remote Sensing. We wrote it back in 2001 originally for the Themis mission to Mars, and it's been expanded from there to include the Moon, Mercury, Earth, other moons, Jupiter and Saturn, Vesta, and we're going to be doing some work for our Q43, which is with the Osiris-Rex mission to an asteroid. It's going to launch in 2016. So we really expanded from the Mars aspect of it, although we kind of keep the JMars as kind of our brand so that everything sticks together. Fundamentally, it's a GIS tool for viewing global and local images. We have a lot of global maps in there. We have the standard MOLA topography, a lot of Themis maps, a lot of test mineral maps that are put together in advance by scientists. We also allow viewing of local images, so individual Themis images, high-rise images, prism images, etc. You can create your own shape files. You can import some standard shape files. We have a Doom database that you can load in with a click of a button. We allow people to sort of publish their data through us. So a lot of times people will put a map into a publication or a shapefile into a publication, and they don't have a really good way of then sharing that information with people. But if you send that to us, we can actually integrate it into our tool so that the next person comes by and says, I want to work with this data set someone else put together, and we can make it really easy to load into the tool. Big points, it's free, it's open source, and because it's written in Java, it's cross-platform, so it runs on Windows, Mac, and Linux. It does not run on the iPad, will not run on the iPad. We're a very heavy client for by design, and there's many new tools that do run in other environments. You're not one of those. JMars was originally written actually as mission planning software. It's used by the Themis team. It's also used by the HiRISE team and the LROC team for the Moon, which is a large part of why we ended up doing the JMoon product and branching out from there. But as part of this mission planning process, our mission planners really wanted to know what other data had been collected and be able to look at it in context with what they were actively acquiring and what they wanted to acquire in the future. So we started pulling in Viking data, test data, mock data, and started snowballing, and then we brought the HiRISE, CTX, PRISM, and our goal is to really have all of the Mars orbital data available easily in JMars. And we're pretty close to that. So actually, the users for JMars, anybody can use JMars. They were actively used for four different active NASA missions. For planetary scientists, the graduate students, undergrad, high school students, we have a really advanced and successful program. It's called the Mars Student Imaging Program at ASU that works with high school and middle school kids all around the world. Largely in the U.S., but other places as well. So we really are providing the software to a certain extent to be used by both fifth graders or principal scientists on NASA missions. And I'll let you guys decide which one is a harder user to design for. Couple stats up there. JMars the last couple of years has been launched 72,000 times. We have 900 actual registered users. You don't have to register to use our tool. There are a few benefits, like the ability to actually share your data set with other users. But if you don't want to tell us who you are, if you want to be completely anonymous, if you want to be lazy, you can fire up the tool, use it without ever telling us who you are. But I do keep track of IP addresses just for fun. We had almost 7,000 different IP addresses that used our tool last couple of years. And when we did a breakdown, it turned out there were 42 different countries that were actively using JMars to do different kind of research. So one of our philosophies, I know this is impossible to read, which is kind of the point. But this is actually the data processing flow for the Themis instrument, which we're most familiar with at the Mars Space Flight Facility. our goal with JMars is to really make it so the user doesn't have to know this. We really want you to be able to come in and use the tool and use the image data and find what's useful for you to you without having to understand the 50-step process of how the data got there. On the other hand, we do link you back to this 50-step process, so if once you found something, you really want to know if it's a legitimate science piece of data or if it's some sort of noise in the image, you can actually go back and you can do all the calculations yourself, and we have it hidden in from you. We want to try and keep you from having to do that up front. And so with all the different data sets that we have available in JMars, our goal is to really have some of the scientists on our side do the upfront legwork, produce some simple and quick browse images that you can look at, and then let you actually get into doing some reconnaissance and find the data you're interested in. So the current version of JMars, and I put these numbers up yesterday, there's a lot of different images. These are actual images. You can find the footprints for these different instruments. But beyond that, you can actually render the image. You can look at them in full resolution in JMars, in context, and compare them with other images, other maps, other data sets, right on your desktop. We basically do this by, we have a reasonably powerful system on our back end that pulls just the portion of the image that you actually need for the scene you're looking at. So we either scale it down or crop it down to the right tiles or both, so that you don't have to download gigabytes of data to your system before you can see it, but we actually do give you images in situ and let you actually look at them. So the bottom line of this one is we have over 2 million actual individual images acquired from orbital, derived products also with orbital images that you can look at in JMars, or Mars. And beyond that, we also have a large number of images that are available for the Moon via LROC. We have Mercury data. We have Earth data, actually. We're working on putting astrocenes in there. And we've got Galileo images for some of the moons of Jupiter and Saturn. Quick demonstration, and again, for a much better demonstration of things, come see my breakout session on Wednesday. The goal is to really let you find data quickly. So what we have here on the screen is, I think it's this background, this is the Themis Golden Mosaic, and the outline there is actually a high-rise DTM. And my goal with this example is just to find what prism data actually have overlapped in the same area. And so you basically select it, you right-click, this little context menu pops up, and it says, well, find the stamps that intersect. This guy, pick prism off of that, and a couple seconds later you can see that here's the prism outlines that actually apply to this area. And if you want to, I don't give you an example of this, but if you want to, you can render all of those, you can see what they look like, you can decide on them if that's data that you're interested in or not. You can start with arbitrary polygon, you can draw one yourself, you don't have to use an existing stamp image, but it's really that easy to find the data that's interested, that relates to your area. This is an example, actually, of that same DTM image rendered in JMars. You can see the level of detail there. The scale bar at this point is 250 meters. But we let you, any high-rise image now, thanks to the JPF server, the high-rise team that's in Tucson, we allow you to basically stream that data into JMars and look at any high-rise image at full resolution. For the data, numeric data sets, which includes high-rise DTMs, HRC DTMs, Themis infrared data, Themis temperature data, at least, we also allow you to actually look at numeric data. So in this image, it's very hard to see, but there's actually a profile line that's drawn on there. And on the next slide, we're plotting the actual elevation from this DTM image across that profile line. Just a couple quick additional examples. We allow you to do some map processing. And so starting here, basically, with an example of molar colorized elevation, we can bring in the Themis Day and IR global mosaic, and basically a quick map processing in the map layer of JMars, you can create actually a colorized MOLA over Themis Day IR, which is a higher resolution color image than you started with. Similarly, with the Themis Night IR and the Themis Day IR, we can combine those together in JMars to create a nice image that has certain things jump out. I'm not a scientist, I'm not going to tell you what those things are. Scientists tell me that's usable. It's just really kind of the design philosophy for JMars. People come to me and say, hey, this is hard, can you make it easier? This is useful, could you add this in? And I say, sure, and then they tell me if I did it right or not. Additional features, I didn't like go over here, but I'll go over more on Wednesday, so if people are interested. You can create your own shape files, you can bring in your own shape files. You can import and share, as Jim pointed out, your own custom maps. We actually have a wind vector layer in JMars, which is based on thermal inertia and a lot of other properties that you can actually look at what direction the model says the wind should be going in different areas. You can tag and count impact craters. Well, we're actually working in the very near future in making the recent crater database that we published a few months ago available in JMars, with the idea that you could then intersect that with an arbitrary shape, export that, put it into crater tools, and get a really quick age estimation. Finally, we do have actually a 3D view in JMars where you can project whatever scene you produce in JMars over a 3D topography or elevation. We also had an interesting request from somebody on the JGrid side to be able to project over non-elevation sources. So actually, you can project data over any numeric data set that you have available to you, which has some interesting potentials. So for more information, the JMars demo is Wednesday at 2:45. Someone else said, I'm happy to meet with anybody individually and give you an individual demo if you want to catch me during the week. A colleague of mine, Sada Anwar, is also presenting another presentation on JMars on Thursday, which will have a little bit more of the technical details of how we do things. Our website has got some good information on it. And you can always email us at help@jmars.asu.edu. And we've got some real human people that actually get back and answer questions and try to help out. So, thank you.
Okay, we have time for questions or comments.
This is Trent from USGS. Sorry if I missed it. At some point, we were talking about being able to export, say something, an image from JMars. Is that on the works?
Right. So we have the ability to export the scene that you produce. It is not currently geo-registered. That is still something that is high on our list, and we intend to get there, but it's not there to the level that we would like to be.
All right. Good. Thanks.
Yeah.